Hi, John. How are you?
How are you?
I have to make sure I have your right mic on. I'm not particularly good at this job.
Right here?
Yes, sir. Welcome to the show.
Hey, thank you.
Jim, I think you're doing great. You're not getting enough positive reinforcement this morning.
Thank you. None of my friends are helping me. None of my friends are being supportive.
Because I think no one said anything.
Yeah. I hit the right button. But you're someone I've wanted to talk to for years, so I appreciate you being here.
Oh, thank you. Thanks for having me.
Okay, I do have the microphone on. And obviously, how many years were you in the FBI?
25.
What did you do before that?
Air Force.
Were you always the guy who was, because you're such a genius at picking out like personality things and patterns. Were you good at that with people before you got into the FBI?
Yeah, I was pretty good when I was a young kid. I was pretty good. But then again, on the other hand, I'm the kind of guy, I give everyone the benefit of the doubt, and sometimes they could take advantage of me. I've had that happen, to me. And I'll let them go so far, then I'm going to get you. But I've been taken advantage of.
How do you feel about violence being, like, Gavin DeBecker did a really interesting book called The Gift of Fear about violence being predictable. Do you think that violent behavior is always predictable?
It is. In fact, I know Gavin very, very well. And it was a great, great book that he did. Yeah, there are certain things you can spot early on in childhood in particular. And the people that I interviewed, some of these violent offenders, some horrific ones over the years, it was predictable that they would commit some type of crime, some interpersonal type of crime. And the guy, this one down in South Carolina that I just interviewed, he 2 years ago, you may have heard about, he had a woman they rescued in a container.
Oh, yeah, I just saw footage of that. Yeah,
Todd Colehep. And he wants to know from me, he killed four people in a motorcycle shop, and that's how I got initially involved. The cops heard me speaking at a university and wanted me to work the case, and it was a damn good analysis that they didn't follow through, and then the guy went on to kill three more people, but extremely bright. So he wants me to, he's very introspective, he wants me to tell him, really what makes him tick. And I said, it was very predictable here, Todd, with you. I mean, you were brought into this world, your mother didn't want anything to do with you. She pretty much abandoned you at an early age. Your father, nothing there. You were sexually assaulted by a neighbor. You then try to match up, or go back to your dad, who now is in Tempe, Arizona, and he doesn't want anything to do with you, but you're living with him. He's away on a business trip. You decide to rape a 14-year-old girl when you're 15 years of age. You now spend 15 years in a state prison for men, not for young boys. And he becomes even more criminally violent. However, he's smart. The guy has about 140 IQ. Gets out at age 30, goes back to South Carolina, picks up a couple of college degrees, picks up a real estate license, broker's license, owns a real estate company, gets a private plane. But he's got this habit. He's got this problem. If you piss him off, he's going to get you. He's not going to get you right away. He's going to wait. He's going to wait until things die down. So when he bought his bike at his motorcycle shop, that's how things started. He couldn't really ride a bike, so he crashed it. And he goes back, and he wants the bike shop to make a deal with him. And they all make fun of him. They laugh at him. Screw you. That's your
tough
luck. And so he goes back, and he believed, and we believe too, that the bike shop came back and he actually stole the bike from him, because it was a chop shop, trying to be chop shop. So he waits, a couple of years, and then he goes, and he's in school, and this is the day I'm going to get him. And so he gets his weapons and loads up two weapons and goes into the bike shop as if he's going to buy another bike. And he starts maneuvering around, and he starts off in the back of the shop where the mechanic is working on a bike, and two hands a 38 and shoots the guy in the back of the head. A woman comes out of the office, business office, shoots her multiple times, and then her son and a manager, they head out the front door, and he mows them down. And I did the analysis, and I said, what is this? I said, well, look, this is not a criminal enterprise. There was nothing taken from the victims, nothing out of the shop at all. And there's $60,000 in the shop. No bike is taken. This is not a sexually a motivated type of crime either. What is it? It's a personal cause homicide. This is the type of homicide where there is some connection between the unsub and this shop, this group of people here. And so his name is going to be on file. He's going to be the disgruntled customer here. The cops started looking through the indices, and then they stopped. They stopped because they were focused in on a theory they had on a guy who came to the scene onto the scene and saw all the victims there. And they didn't like his demeanor, his affect they thought was wrong. So for years and years, they focused on him. And while that name was still in that in those indices, and then it was Todd Colehepa went on to kill three more people. And then that's when they rescued the girl in the storage container.
Didn't he kill her husband first?
Killed that boyfriend.
A boyfriend.
Or the boyfriend, and he also killed another couple. So he's trying, he wants me to figure him out. I mean, it's pretty, yeah. Hey, Todd, I said, I don't forgive you at all. You knew right from wrong. You knew the nature and consequences of your actions. You decide to make the choice, and you're going to kill. I mean, that's why, that's it. And it's predictable, but I'm sorry. You know, I don't have any really empathy for you.
And you've talked to all these guys. You've talked to Gacy, to Bundy, yeah, to Kemper. Wow. Do you ever find
Charles Manson.
You did talk to him.
Yeah.
Do you ever find these guys, do you ever like them? Like, do you ever talk to them and go like, wow, as a guy, I actually like this person?
Very much so. One of the worst it was Ed Kemper in the first season of Mindhunters.
Yeah,
Mindhunter
series. That guy was pretty good who played him, too.
Yeah, yeah, because the real guy, I'm 6'2", the real guy is 6'9". Cameron Britton is 6'5", but he did a tremendous job. And, Kemper kills his grandparents when he's 15. Then he ends up killing half a dozen college co-eds in California. The problem is, dear mommy, it's always a mother thing with these guys. It's always a mother thing. And he reminded her of the ex-husband, who hated him. So as a little kid, lock him down in the basement next to a furnace where he'd fantasize with the devil. And he had his sister's dolls down there, and he cut the heads off and the arms off of the dolls, something that later in the fantasy, that was the fantasy. The fantasy would then act out in reality, and that's what he would do to the victims. He would kill the co-eds, cutting their arms off, cutting their legs off. And that's how he ends up killing his mother while she's sleeping in bed. He's had enough of her, and he goes up to her in bed, hits her in the head with a ball peen hammer, cuts her head off, rips out the larynx, and attempts to throw it down. He's talking to me. He's laughing. He tried to throw it down the garbage disposal, and it pops out. And even now, he said, even now, this bitch, and now she's still nagging at me. And then he goes on and kills a next-door neighbor, and then he takes off. But he's a character. He's a real character. I mean, the crimes are horrific here. 145 IQ this guy had. I kid around. I say that was the total IQ of me and the agent that was with you. Well, we had about probably 145. But you learn so damn much from that. You know, let me give you an example here. I said, how do you get these girls? He would cruise. Now we're on the internet. You can throw out lines on the internet and go fishing, go hunting, and see if you get a nibble. But back then it was the cruising. Cruising around. Well, how did you get him? He said, well, first of all, after girls started missing, they said, go with someone with a university sticker. My mother worked at the university, so that was a good start. But the problem I had is when I pulled up alongside of the curb, I'm so big, I filled up the seat of the car. And so when college co-ed looks in there and says, oh, my God, they're afraid to come in. So what did you do? So what I decided to do is that I would do the same thing. I pulled up alongside of the curb. The girl says, where she wants to go, but you can see they're afraid. What I would do is I would just look at my watch. I'd look at my watch and hold it up to me, and then I turn back to them. I said, okay, if you want a ride, I can give you a ride. See, what it's telling the potential victim here is this guy has a place to go. He's got an appointment. He's got to go somewhere. So it's safe to go with him. He's not going to do anything to me. He's on his way.
He's in a rush.
So just a little thing like that. And then I put in a chapstick. He had a chapstick in the old handles of the Ford Fairlines. Used to have a squeeze grip. Put a chapstick in there. So once they get in, they couldn't get out of the door. But very gregarious guy. And like Charles Manson, just very... If you had Charles Manson in here right now, you'd be surprised how small. He's 5'2", inches tall.
He's 5'2"?
5'2". But what he would do, if we were going to talk to him, it's what he did to me, he would find a chair here and sit up on top of the chair so he could dominate us, so he could look down over us like he did at the George Spahn Ranch when he had his Manson family as he preached to his flock out there. He would lecture that way, and that's what he did to me. He just dominated. But I don't care. I'm trying to get information.
Right, so you don't care what he's trying to do.
No, I want that. I want him. And Richard Speck, who killed nurses in Chicago, now he was a big guy. He was a big, ugly guy, and the crimes that he committed. And he, too, was really, really, well, they had him in a cage waiting for me. And then what's really, it's not so much the bad guy who's frightening. It's sometimes, it's the environment. And so you're walking into this prison and there's four tiers. He's back in a cage. Wild birds are going through broken glass windows. They want me to see his pornography in a cell. And so he sees me walk in the cell. He starts MFing me, you know, FBI, MF this, MF that. And I tell the counselor, forget about it. So now I got to go into the cage with him where we have chairs and a credenza. He is up on top of this credenza. What I decided to do, because he's MFing me the whole time here, I'm going to totally ignore the guy here. And I turned my back to him. I turned my back, and his counselor is sitting next to me. And I said, you know, the thing about it is, you know, I said, I just don't understand it. What is that, John? I said, I don't understand what this guy, what he eats for breakfast here. And what are you talking about? He says, the counselor said, I said, you know, he effed. These are the language you use in that situation. You know, seven, you know, these seven nurses here. And he says, yeah, I always wonder what the heck. And he chimes in, spec, I didn't F all those women. I didn't F those women. And I turned around and said, I know, you just F the one on the couch, right? And that totally opened up the interview with me. And the thing, which is unlike in shows that you see on television, I made mistakes in the beginning. I'd go in there with notes. I'd go in there with like a little tape recorder. There's such paranoid individuals, particularly when I've interviewed assassins like James Earl Ray, Sirhan Sirhan, Arthur Bremer, Squeaky Fromm, who shot at Ford, you know, Sarah Jane Moore, who shot at Ford. I found out if you go in with, they're such so paranoid, they don't like it. You know, why are you taking notes? What are you doing here? Why do you have the tape recorder? Who's going to hear, you know, the tape recording? And so what the key was to really memorize the case, know the case backwards and forwards. You don't need, you know, anything, and get that low lighting, that overhead lighting, limited kind of furniture, and extremely, extremely relaxed, and have a conversation, not a lecture, a conversation, you know, with him. And when I did that, then it started, the information started flowing.
Was he the most interesting man in the world?
Yeah.
Jesus, man.
And the books are great. By the way, you are promoting. I have a specific question about a case for you, too. The Killer Across the Table is your new book. Obviously, Mindhunter, and there were follow-ups to that. Incredible, fascinating, because it doesn't feel exploitive, because you actually worked, and this is your job, and you've helped catch a lot of these people.
Well, I helped now Amanda Knox. I was here in New York a couple of weeks ago on a stage with Amanda Knox and Joe Berlinger, who has the Ted Bundy. Sure. I helped her get out of prison, as well as the West Memphis Three, Damien Echols, who lives now in New York City. They were wrongfully convicted when they were teenagers, spent 18 years in prison.
Who do you think did that? They said those bite marks were animal bite marks. Who do you think did that?
No, they.
Oh, they weren't.
Well, yeah, Terry. No, they were. They were bite marks. But the medical examiner said, Frank Peretti, who's the medical examiner down there, who's not board certified, said that the knife, it was knife wounds, serrated knife wounds. And we brought in some of the top forensic people in the country, and it was Peter Jackson, a Lord of the Rings, who brought me in. He saw the case, Paradise Lost, with HBO, where they brought cameras in the courtroom, and you see how these guys were wrongfully, you know, convicted. So we brought all these and experts in forensics and gave them the evidence separately, and they came up with animal predation, that it was no knife wound involved in here, and the wounds, because we're in that creek where the bodies were found naked, the subject stripped these 3 8-year-old boys down and threw them in there, held their clothing underwater with sticks. That tells you some criminal sophistication here. But it was alligator snapping turtles and fish that made the marks, and here you have an expert testify that was made with a serrated knife. And it was all, it was full of baloney. So I just did it. I was on a panel with him. They're just so grateful. And Amanda Knox, too. But there's still people out there that believe that they're guilty.
But is that crime unsolved? And do you think, there was fingers pointed at one of the stepdads.
Yes.
Is that a possibility?
Yeah, because what happened, that stepdad wanted to kill me. It's not the one you think.
Not the crazy looking one.
Not Mark Byers.
Not Mark Byers.
No, not that he turned around and started defending them.
Terry something.
But I had to interview Mark Byers, who was angry as hell, because part of my job was to to convince the families of victims where they thought they have closure. No, the wrong guys are in prison. So, man, he was ready to want to beat the hell out of me, and we became really close. It's not him, but my analysis that I did led to another stepfather of one of the victims who was never interviewed by the police department at all, had a history of violence, a history of abuse against the stepchild that was in the water and dead. And then we find mitochondrial DNA that was never processed. His head hair through mitochondrial, I mean, it's on the mother's side at the crime scene on a branch and under the ligature of one of the victims. His head hair under the ligatures, and he is a viable suspect. He should have been a viable suspect when the crime was committed in the mid 90s back there. So he's walking around, and it's a case of solvable. But if you have a police department that's not willing to work the case, they're not going to solve it. And then the DA, they had me speak to the DA because I've worked with both sides now, defense prosecutors, and he. I get on the phone with him, and he saw this show, and the show that I was involved called West of Memphis with Peter Jackson, and our analysis that we did. And they said, John, we want you to do the interview. The attorney said, because you've worked on both sides, but this guy may not be like you. He may be mad when he sees how we portray him in this show West of Memphis. So I end up talking to him on the phone, and he says, John, what do they want? What do they want? And I said, what they want? They want to be exonerated. They're still convicted. They're convicted child killers here. Well, I don't know the case, he says. And I said, well, I do know the case. I do know the case, and they had nothing to do with it. And this was like a new prosecutor. They had nothing to do with this crime. Everyone has dropped the ball. And so then he tells me, he says, the timing isn't good. I said, what do you mean the timing isn't good? And he wouldn't tell me. But a month later, I see he's running for Congress. Yeah. He's running for a political office. So he's more concerned about his constituents than he is about trying to come up with a clearance and we can solve this case. So you see stuff like that, or JonBenet Ramsey case. I was involved with that, and the FBI hated me and the local police. I went in thinking they're guilty. I'm out of the bureau thinking they're guilty. Look at the case, interview the family, have the data on the crime. No. The parents, John and Patsy Ramsey, did not kill their child. Wow. Parents kill, but they don't kill that way in that style. I mean, JonBenet is on her last breath. She's on her last breath with her hands bound over her head, a tape across her mouth, where the subject still this angry at not necessarily the child. I believe it was displaced aggression, and he ends up crushing her skull.
What about the brother?
No,
too young.
No, and the brother.
Shout out to Boulder, Colorado.
It was a disgrace. It was a disgrace what CBS did with the show. And they were FBI.
That stuff gets me.
FBI agents. They were profilers. There was medical examiners, famous ones in this country. And you just don't point the finger at some kid. He was nine years of age.
I believe whatever the last documentary I saw says.
Yeah, me too.
That's I'm my fully
problem.
In.
That's my problem.
Yeah, that's it. Yeah, because they'll make it so. Well, what happened? It's their problem. They were sued. They were sued. CBS was
for like $100 million or something. Right?
Yeah.
Can I ask something about
settled recently?
About the West Memphis Three.
Yes.
Is it simply those parents will never get to find out officially who killed their children because the deal they made was so the police can't get sued by the three boys? They let them out under the guise. They say, we're closing the case, though, right? Like, you guys did it. You're admitting that, and we're letting you out of jail, though, right? That's the idea. So they can't be sued.
Yeah, it is. What is the word I'm looking for?
Alford plea.
That's right. Alford plea. That we have to plead guilty, but that's right. So they can't get any money. But we're claiming our innocence. We had nothing to do with it. But they would have evidence to prove it. There was no evidence. There is nothing forensically. They got Jesse Miskelly with a 72 IQ to confess to the crime.
And 18 hours. Summary.
Just like with Amanda Knox, they had 40 hours, 10 detectives on. They could get you or me to confess because you know why? If we didn't do a crime, what happens is we think, well, I'm not going to get an attorney because I'm innocent. I don't need an attorney. But this badgering, breaking you down over a period of time, I will think that this will get straightened out. I just got to get out of here. This will get straightened out by my attorney.
I assume that's what it was because Damien Echols particularly, I always found it interesting. that in the first of the three documentaries that HBO did, when they, he was steering into it. Like, he liked the idea that he was, you know, he was like a goth kid, so he liked the idea that he was being seen that way, and he goes, in this town forever, there's I'll be the boogeyman now. Like, and he was like, you know, doing the very emo kind of goth thing. I think because he just believed, like, well, we didn't do it, so they're eventually we're going to get off from this.
That's right.
And I'll be awesome.
But the problem is, you see, but the problem is that then they get a, a written confession. They get a written confession. But the interview was not televised. It was not, you know, not taped. There was no audio tape. Or if they have departments that have audio tape or videotape, they may turn it on at the point of the confession. This should be a law. They should have taping, if you're a suspect, from the moment you go into that interview room right to the, you know, right to the end when it's, you know, when it's completed. And the, and it's not, in fact, the FBI doesn't even have that with those kind of interrogations. And that's what happened to him, you know, with them.
You've seen such horrific stuff. Do you view the world as pretty in a negative light? Like, I couldn't do your job. I'd go home and cry.
I was kind of wondering the same thing.
Like, I'd be so sad.
Do you talk to, like, Richard Speck and then go home and watch, like, Fresh Prince of Bel-Air on TV? Like, how do you laugh and just kick back?
Well, I thought it was pretty good out there until I came into this room. I thought, oh, my God, this is, oh, there's some, do some good studies here. No, it's really hard. And this is, I nearly died when I was 38 on the Green River murder case in Seattle, viral encephalitis. I was doing, I was training several hundred cops in New York City here. And during my presentation, I was doing so much work around even the world at that point with some cases that I had anxiety and attack. I thought I was having a heart attack.
Is that from the workload, though? Yeah. Because when you interview, like, a serial killer, these horrific crimes, don't you go home at night like, what is happening in the world?
That happens, too. But it was the work. It's the workload. It is the nature of the work. And because you do come home and you think about it.
Do you have children?
Yes, three. And you're in bed with your wife. Yeah. You may want to, you may have a little, you know, whoopee or something, and then you're thinking you may be doing it, in fact, and then but now you're thinking of this lust murder case where a woman was eviscerated, and
you see files like pictures of all these horrific
pictures,
scenes.
I've been at the site down in Tech and all over at the crime scenes where this one guy was. Decapitated a victim's head and had it on a shelf as we walked into the crime scene. And another one came in the crime scene, he had her naked spread eagle. She was right at the door as the door opened, she is. That's traumatic. And then what's traumatic is dealing with victims. Like, for example, in the current book, The Killer Across the Table is Delisandro, a little 7-year-old brownie who's going to be murdered by a school teacher in New Jersey, Hillsdale, New Jersey. And she wants me to tell her all the specifics. Her daughter was sexually assaulted. Her daughter, the guy, McGowan, he's a big guy. He's about 6'2", real strong, real buff since he's been in prison. But he had a master's degree, and he had to kill somebody that day. He was demoted in his job. He broke up with his fiance. It was Easter time. They didn't invite him on with the rest of the faculty to go on a trip. And here, I do this interview. It was a fascinating interview. And I said, tell me when did it start? When I heard the knock on the door. When I heard the knock on the door. And I looked up and I saw her there. And it was Joan Delisandro, 7 years of age, there to collect $2 at that time for Girl Scout cookies. He is getting ready to get out of prison. He served the maximum sentence, 30 years, and which these laws now have been changed thanks to the mother of this, victim here. And so he goes through all of the horrific details of what he does with the girl and tells me how difficult it is to strangle somebody, and talks about how he then had to pick her up by her feet and swing her body and crash her head into the floor, how he cleaned up the crime scene, drove her to New York, disposed of her in a park right across the border, went back home, how he injected himself into the search party so he wouldn't be suspicious. Well, Mrs. Delisandro wanted me to, by the way, when I interviewed him for about 5 hours, it was a fascinating interview, fascinating, because he forgot who I was during the interview. He would later tell somebody he realized I had no notes or anything, but I knew his case extremely, extremely well. he started telling me, I said, I talk positive. I said, when you get out, where are you going? He says, New York. I said, man, New York. I said, man, I was born in Brooklyn and raised out in Hempstead and Long Island. And I said, it's expensive, man. It's expensive. And he looks over his shoulder to see if the guards are watching us and listening, and they're not. And he says, John, I got money, though. Money? Well, I'm making license plates? Where'd you get the money? He said, when my mother died, I got money from insurance. My grandmother, he was living with them. That's another problem he had. He got money from that, and he got money through the sale of the house. But he turns around again, and he comes back to me, and he says, I put the money out of state. Why'd you put the money out of state? So the victim's family can't get any of the money. Wow. I said, well, hell, I said, oh, how much was it? $650,000. Oh, man, you could do real well, man. You could do well. When you get to New York, you'll have plenty of money. The next day, I go down. I have to go before the parole board, where I proceed to dunk his ass, man, before the parole board.
Good.
And they're shocked at how I'm able to get the information out of him. Wow. And I said, I'm able to get the information out of him because you guys, you know, I didn't tell him this part, but oftentimes they're political appointees by the governor. They don't have the criminal background. And I said, you guys rely on self-reporting. You're just not reading any of the police reports, nothing really about them. You're trying to make a decision based upon your education, whatever your experience is.
They're not doing their homework.
And so you believe these people are going to be telling you the truth, that you're going to ask Joseph McGowan, how do you feel? Do you still get the urge? You think you'd kill again? No, Doc. I feel great. Okay, I've been a model prisoner. And that's another thing, this model prisoner stuff. Yeah, you should be a model prisoner.
Whaley finds out Girl Scout cookies are $6 a box now.
Yeah. Well, what happened was he got a hit. He got a hit of 30 more, but he's not going to serve the full 30. He's not happy with me. I'll be a guy he'll be looking for if he gets out. But going back to the mother, Mrs. D'Alessandro wanted me to describe all the details of how her child was murdered. Ugh. I didn't want to do it.
Was it because she said she experienced it, she wanted to experience it too?
She had to live with it. I want to know what it was. Yeah, no, wait, well, she, yeah, she, well, you're, in a way, you're right, because what she said, I said, your daughter fought. And my little Joni, she's a fighter. And that's why I'm going to fight. I'm going to fight for her to change the laws in New Jersey and New York so that people like this can't get out of prison. And there's a tendency in law enforcement, like we want to protect. Of course, we want to protect the victim. And so you don't want to provide that information, but sometimes they really do. They want to know what was my child experiencing? What did he do to my child, to my wife? You do it.
Person had to suffer through it. I mean, if they had to suffer through it, I should have to live with it. Now, I want to ask you, too, about because we're running out of time here, the Wayne Williams case in Atlanta, the Atlanta child killer.
Yes.
I was shocked to read that you think other people are involved, and maybe they are. Yeah. Can you talk about how, because he's such a meek and quiet guy. Can you talk briefly about how the local cops thought it was like the Klan and how you got him on what advice you gave the prosecutor on the stand for him?
Yeah, you did your homework. You know this stuff. It was brought down in the case 1981. Still a young guy, just stuff developing all the techniques and learning from all these guys. And I go down there, and I said this offender, which was is going to be black, and that drove the FBI crazy. Everyone, like I was going to create a race war by coming out with that, by saying, and we did studies down there. There was no way that a white guy could have gotten into this neighborhood. These children, they would do anything for $5, by the way. The poverty was so bad and remains in sections to be bad, but using white cops and black cops, you could lure children for $5 to get into the car. However, with these hate crimes, generally it's really symbolic types of homicides. They're symbolic. They're symbolically, maybe it's the way the bodies are positioned after they kill them, or they hang them on Main Street. So the crime, there's a message they want, and they want the message to be heard and seen. And so they don't hide the bodies. The first bodies were being hidden here. So went through the whole tactics of did a profile, the age group, probably in all probability a former, you know, like a police buff, and they end up busting. When we busted Williams, he was impersonated a police officer in his career. He was in his mid, you know, 20s. He wanted to be like a manager of a Jackson 5 type of group. I got him on the bridge when he was, we heard splashes in the water. We knew the next bodies, or I did, that were going to end up in the water. The reason was, and we had it staked out, was because the ME was shooting his mouth off talking about getting hair and fiber evidence off of the bodies. And now the bad guy will know that. Now he's going to wash the hairs and fibers. So the river down there is the Chattahoochee River. The bodies are going to end up in the Chattahoochee. So use police cadets, all types of different types of police departments, staking out all the bridges there. And after about the third night or so, there's a splash in the water. Williams is up on the bridge. They should have hauled his ass in there that night for some reason. Bureau didn't do it. They had enough probable cause. They looked in the car. They saw ligatures in the back seat of the car. A couple of days later, they find bodies in the Chattahoochee. It floated downstream. So they did that part. And then the major part, well, that was a major part, but it was the cross-examination of Williams. During the trial, I sat there and coaching the prosecutors. And this one day, I tapped him. I said, one week from today, Williams is going to get sick in the courtroom. And prosecutor Gordon Miller said, what? He said, why? I said, because you're winning the case now. You weren't doing so good. Our forensic experts were talking too scientific. The jurors can't even understand. I had no idea what they're even saying. And so he's going to feign some kind of sickness. And they thought I was crazy. I go back to Quantico. Next thing you know, they want me back. Wayne Williams got sick in the courtroom. They took him to the hospital. Nothing was wrong with him. But now Williams is down. He's so confident. He's going to take the stand. He's going to take the stand. And his defense attorney named Al Binder, nicknamed Jaws, picks up Williams' hands, holds Williams' hands of his hands and say, look at this hands. You think these are the hands of a killer? These are the hands of a serial killer? You know, he's like the Pillsbury Doughboy. Could this kill anyone? So when my time came to talk to Jack Mallard now, who's going to be on the cross-examination of him, I said, Jack, this is what you're going to do. I said, because he held the hands, Binder did, of his client here, you're going to hold the hands. But when you hold his hands, you're going to be saying in a low voice, what was it like, Wayne, when you wrapped your fingers around Terry Pugh's throat? Did you panic, Wayne? Did you panic? And he did that day in a low voice, just so the jurors can hear him and everyone close, not everyone in the courtroom. And Williams said, no. And all of a sudden he caught himself, and then he gets up, starts screaming and yelling, starts pointing a finger across at me. He said, I know you got that FBI profile here. I know you're trying to get me to fit him, you know, and he just went crazy. And the jurors are going back now looking, oh my God, look at this guy, the Pillsbury Doughboy. You could see he's got this violence in him. And so that was really a turning point in that case. However, let's back to your original question. No, he's tied forensically hair and fiber evidence to about 10, 11 of cases. So me and another agent, when I was down there, we did an analysis of all of them. We put these 10 or 11, I think it was, together. And coincidentally, that's the case, all happened to be the cases where they found the hair and fiber evidence, not the other ones. There are some cases down there that are personal cause. I believe they're family. That means family-related homicides. Every year in Atlanta, there's about 10 or 12 children that are killed. So it's not a question that he didn't do it. He didn't do 25.
He did some, but not all of them.
Yes, right.
Well, your book, John, you're a fascinating guy.
God.
Literally, it's called The Killer Across the Table. new book out now. And before we go, we have to end this show. I have to fly.
Can I ask one question?
Yeah,
of course,
my special.
Yeah.
Buy his book now.
Yeah, of course.
I do. Well, you said something interesting. I thought about the people that would, even though they were small in stature, these murderers that would like. Do you think that's an organic thing, like trying to alpha with certain movements? Because I just watched the HBO documentary about the USA gymnastics team being molested for years by the doctor.
Oh, yeah.
And he pleaded guilty, and they sentenced him to have to watch or sit through all of the testimonies of his victims.
Yes. Yeah.
And when he gave his final statement at the end of all that, you know, he cried during some of those testimonies. But when he gave his testimony, he kept like stepping away from the mic. He was looking to the judge and reading his statement, but he kept turning around and like sweeping the audience, which was pretty much full of all of his victims. And which I, untrained eye, wouldn't have thought anything of. I would have thought that was him just trying to look at them and say, wow, I'm so sorry. Yeah. Hearing all that, I realized what a piece of shit I am. And the judge called him, and they said they had a bunch of like experts say that. He goes, no, that's him still trying. Like, my question is always, is that thought of or is that organic? Do you think it comes with the profile, or is it something where they go, what did he know? He goes, I'm going to look them in the eyes so maybe they feel sympathy for me.
It's control. These crimes are our control. He was a predator relying on young children, just like some predators will go after very, very old people. It's like the lion on a Serengeti plain. They're not going to go after the water buffalo that's healthy there. You always see the shows. There's thousands of them. And always, but the lion is focused in on one. They can smell it. And here they go. And maybe someone really small or one that's lame. And they zero in on him. So, that's... he picked on, he was a predator. He was a predator and he got away with it by his position.
Yeah.
Like a school teacher would or a coach would. You got to be.
That's what I mean. Like Charles Manson, you said when he sits up on the chair, he knows, he goes, I'm going to sit above these people. Or is he just organically, you think, kind of do
no,
that?
No, he has to. Well, he physically has to do it. I mean, he can speak well and sing song and almost like a preacher, but he physically has to show this, this kind of domination.
Does he know he's doing it? Does he say to himself, I'm going to dominate these people by being over them, or is it just something that animal instinct just says to get up?
Probably after a while. I think initially as younger he does it, but after a while it's like second nature.
And can I ask you one more question before we go? Because again, we talk a lot about the press and the school shootings and the fact that it's ramping up and it's ramping up and it's ramping up. And I know guns are a problem. Do you think the media's coverage and the way they will talk about these guys like they're anti-heroes, like after that guy in Aurora, Colorado, calls himself the Joker, the media honors his name and they talk about his lair and his manifesto, do you think they're contributing to the problem?
That's what many of them are looking for. That's why you have copycats. Somebody else wants to do the same thing, so they shouldn't. And some stations, and you'll see, they don't even mention the guy's name at all. They maybe not even show his picture, and they really shouldn't for that type of type of an offender. They shouldn't give him that kind of kind of glory. And I do believe people ask, is it predictable? Yes, there are certain things you can identify early on. Unfortunately, like the schools with some of these are occurring, they're so large, 3,000 students, you get lost in the shuffle and kids like this, but they don't fit in. They don't fit in with the rest of them. But parents know, they can see things, or they can see indicators of future violence. You may have read about or heard me say before, animal cruelty is a biggie. That's a big one, animal cruelty. Used to be called the homicidal triangle with enuresis due to psychological, physical abuse. Not so as important as the other one. The other one was fire setting, like David Berkowitz here in New York City, set over 2,000 fires, documented by his diaries. Power, control, but cruelty to animals. When you have a young child, which is showing that kind of behavior, you got to study why did he do it? What's going on here? Was it accidental or what? But if it's intentional, when he threw gasoline on this dog and set the dog on fire, and what is his affect, afterwards? If there's nothing, no intervention here, you're going to see him down the road. I guarantee it. Law enforcement will be seeing him committing other interpersonal violence, domestic violence types of crimes.
Want more Jim and Sam? Catch up with full episodes and interviews from celebrity guests anytime on demand using the SiriusXM app.